I'm starting this with a disclaimer. You will hear things in this video that you might find ignorant, unreasonable, or maybe even bigoted. Let me just make clear that I do not wish to attack anyone's chosen way of life. This video is about exploring my very own fears and prejudices. Logic and reason can only take me so far on this. I sincerely apologize should anyone feel hurt by what I will be talking about. Now let's begin. In an episode of Half in the Bag from Red Letter Media, the two hosts, Mike and Jay, used the phrase comfy nightmare blanket.
Yeah, you watch, it's like the old one. It's a comfy nightmare blanket.
It's what I
you wrap yourself in.
They utilized it to describe a movie that was severely uncomfortable to watch, but in a good way. A movie driven by the experience and the oppressive atmosphere where you just want to sit down, huddle up, and witness terrible, terrible things unfolding. When I experienced sharp objects for the first time, I realized that this was my comfy nightmare blanket. There are many reasons why this show got to me the way it did. The stellar character writing and the performances of the three main actresses certainly did their part, but there was something else to it. Sharp objects played into a deeply rooted anxiety that I have, one that might be particular to me and maybe people who share my upbringing. And with all the misery that this show portrayed, it made me feel even more justified for holding that particular anxiety in the first place. I'm talking about the fear of having to live in a small, insignificant, dead-end rural town. For context, I'm someone who has never lived outside of major cities. Roughly 80% of my 31 years on this earth have been spent in a metropolitan area with 3.7 million people, and the remaining 20% in an area with roughly 800,000 inhabitants. So it's fair to say that I just don't know anything else but the urban lifestyle. And quite frankly, I don't want to know anything else. Because living here has made me grow accustomed to many conveniences, like the limitless amount of stores, the fast internet speeds, and the access to people who share your interests. I would have probably never gotten into niche hobbies like making progressive metal music or playing fighting games if it wasn't for the people I've hooked up with locally. But those are only a few of the reasons why I can't fathom moving to a small village out there in the countryside. In fact, without ever having lived out there, or maybe because I never did, there have always been so many reasons in my mind why those surroundings would drive me fucking crazy. And that's what I observed in Sharp Objects as well. This show portrays the systematic destruction of people living in an insignificant small rural community. What I took away from it, a big part of why these characters behave the way they do and why the underlying murders in the show happen in the first place, is that the life out in the countryside fucks with your mind in many different ways. The show has almost no good or pure characters. The most morally upstanding one is the outsider detective that was sent in from Kansas City to investigate the murder case. The one who people keep calling KC to make it clear to him that he does not belong here. Everyone else grew up and still lives in the small town of Windgap. Except for the main character Camille, who only grew up here, eventually moved out, and now is back to cover the murders for her newspaper. She, just as everyone else though, seems to have been severely damaged and scarred by the life in Windgap. All the people in town seem to secretly loathe their entire living situation. So much so that trying to put myself in their shoes and imagining me living in their stead made me as anxious as if I was watching a horror movie. Every dialogue scene between any of the characters in Sharp Objects is filled with sometimes more, sometimes less contained resentment towards the fellow townspeople, even though these are the only acquaintances they have.
Girls.
It's good to see you, Jackie. You finding everything?
Mm-hmm. Everything found me.
Well, enjoy and please save some liquor for the rest of us.
For example, whenever Camille meets up with the people she used to know from high school, all they do is gossip. They gossip about the murders. They gossip about other people's problems. They gossip to make themselves feel better about their own boring lives. I know this kind of buzz around current events is part of normal human behavior, but the passive-aggressive level most of the characters operate on and the general emptiness of Windgap make it seem like this is virtually all they have to get themselves through the day. Often you can also observe characters interacting with one another on a fairly friendly basis, but the moment one of them turns around and leaves, the toxicity kicks back in and they're starting to talk behind the other's backs.
Look who's putting on airs now. I hate her dress.
In another scene, where Camille is invited to some kind of women's meeting with all of her former friends, it becomes clear that the only purpose for this entire support group is for all the participants to one-up each other's problems and make themselves feel like they got the biggest cross to bear. The entire sequence reveals how massively insecure the townspeople are about their own existences. It becomes clear that the only reason Camille was invited was because she's the hot new object in town, and those women are desperate to befriend her and bring some variety to their lives.
It's gonna be like the old days. You don't have us.
But the moment Camille doesn't play ball and challenges the entire ritual, they band together and immediately turn on her with harsh, passive-aggressive attacks.
That's not fair. Camille doesn't have any children, and I just don't think you can feel the pain the way that we do.
So it's evident that none of these women from Windgap actually enjoy each other's company, yet they hang out every week and annoy each other anyway. And Camille, as the outsider, is a welcome target to forget about this for a moment. In my mind, while I was watching this, I could only come to the conclusion that they go through this self-destructive routine because there's absolutely nothing else to do in towns like this. The stuff that I take for granted. Good cinemas, a variety of restaurants, shops, clubs, themed bars, hobby groups for whatever I might be looking for, and so on. The stuff that I have all around me is what they do not have access to. And look, I'm not even that much of a social butterfly that I have to go out every night and explore the city, but the fact that all these entertainment offers are at my fingertips gives me comfort, because I know that should I be bored and start looking for any pastime, I will most likely find it. It makes me incredibly uncomfortable even imagining what life would be like without that, and having to witness these women drift into this shallow, self-destructive behavior made it so much worse. The male townspeople, of course, aren't any better, often holding in their grievances and at most making understated comments when they got a problem with one of their peers.
Yeah, we've been passing something around the house. I hope you don't catch it.
How's that?
You're up there as much as I am.
Why don't you pull up a chair, Alan? We'll talk this out like men.
Everyone got some kind of resentment towards one another, but nothing is ever really talked about. It's almost absurdist, because these people that have known each other their whole lives have grown so sick of one another that they turned back around to interacting on the most superficial level possible. That's part of the rural lifestyle that legitimately frightens me. This idea of having no escape from seeing and meeting the same people every single day. Even when you just want your peace, they are around. When you want to try something new or do something on your own, the other townspeople see you and make your life their business, whether you like it or not. It's like living in this small of a town poisons you and eventually makes you hate everyone else, but you can't get away from them either. Now, the reason why these people turn on each other is also because of how obviously jaded they are about their own lives and what they can actually achieve with them. This is another aspect of living in such a dead-end province that absolutely scares the shit out of me. To me, it always feels like there's simply no future for you to choose and barely any way to grow personally in a region as limited as this. And that idea was picked up in an interview from the writer Gillian Flynn as well. It's the same thing with the Windgap. You're always known for who your family is. You're known for what you did in third grade. I think you're restricted in a very specific way. It's a place where most people's paths are already set in stone. The men become hog farmers, the women become housewives, and the children are bored out of their minds growing up, only to repeat that shitty adult cycle without much of a choice. Especially the depiction of the youth in Sharp Objects seems so aimless. You can see Emma, Camille's half-sister, and her friends often skating around, not really knowing how to fill the time.
It's because this place is so totally dead.
The same can be seen in other scenes and flashbacks from Camille's high school days, where the teenagers during the formative years of their lives, mind you, have nothing better to do than run around the woods, swim in dirty ponds, or sit around drinking in the dark while chasing pigs. I mean, I'm not saying I myself turned out particularly great, but I'm so glad that's not what my own teenage years looked like. It makes sense to me why, having to deal with this from a young age, people eventually grow dissatisfied with these living conditions and lash out. It makes sense to me why, at the center of sharp objects, there is so much violence, resentment, and aggression. After all, at its core, this is still a mystery show where two teenage girls were found murdered, one of them with all her teeth pulled out. To a significant extent, my mind assigns this senseless act to the sheer frustration of having to live out there in the middle of nowhere. It's a prospect that has always frightened me just thinking about it. And that's why this show was such a nightmare factory to watch. It affirmed all these anxieties, and it was upsetting to see all these people be trapped in that rural hell, driving one another mad. In some scenes, my discomfort was so massive that even as an observer, I felt close to having a panic attack. I can go into much more detail here and also describe all the little things that irrationally angered me because of how they were so completely opposite to the metropolitan life that I know. Architecturally, especially, the town aggravated me. This is actually something that gets to me every time I watch an American show, because these sweeping suburbs with nothing in them that you can see in Breaking Bad, for example, just don't exist where I live, and they always look like the most boring places on earth to me. Except in Sharp Objects, these same principles have been applied to the town itself. Why is there so much room between buildings in Wind Gap? Why are the parking spaces so massive despite how few people there are around? Why do you need to go everywhere by car? Why does it seem like Camille has to take a 30-minute drive to get to her mother's estate? I know the answer is probably because that's how much room we have and there's nothing else around, but it just seems like such a pointless waste of space. Like no one's in a hurry to get anywhere, like no one has anything in their lives to get to. To me, the room between all the major buildings made the town of Wind Gap seem barely coherent, sad and empty, very much reflecting the state of the town's community itself. The house of Camille's mother being that far out also perfectly mirrors her prideful facade that she put up while keeping all her dirty family secrets away from the public. And then, of course, there's the Calhoun Day Festival, which to me seemed like the biggest waste of time of them all. A massive, pointless celebration of both Confederate quote-unquote heroes as well as a morbid historical event in which a child bride was tied to a tree and raped by soldiers during the Civil War, which is then reenacted by local high schoolers.
And this is a holiday.
We don't have a lot of happy stories around here.
While some in town, especially Camille's mother, take this celebration a bit too seriously, many just rightfully smirk at how stupid this tradition is and make jokes about it. And yet, they attend anyway. It's one of those events that you can tell a lot of people only go to because there's nothing else to do all year, and this is as good an excuse as any to drink yourself into a coma. Not to mention that would they be absent, it would absolutely be the talk of the town the next day, and you don't want that either. The fact that a distasteful ritual like Calhoun Day is among the celebratory highlights of this town is to me more proof of how restrictive, forced, and also empty the lives of these people are. I don't know, these might seem like petty complaints stemming from me being unwilling to accept that elsewhere things might be different than what I'm used to. And maybe it really is just me, because after all, I'm the type of person that can watch the Tokyo Dance Trooper video and think that these massive, overcrowded and blinking streets are some of the most idyllic places I've ever seen. But these aspects of Sharp Objects created a massive disconnect with me and led to a feeling of alienness that ultimately turned it into such an engrossing nightmare that I loved and hated to watch at the same time. It felt like I was finally being handed a list of evidence for just how right I was. It felt like I finally had proof that all these fears and worries I had been cultivating my whole life about how awful living in the countryside must be were completely justified. That sort of vindication helped me project myself into it more than I otherwise would have and made the depiction of everyone's suffering so real and understandable to me, which then heightened the overall experience to what I now consider to be one of my favorite shows of all time.
It's beautiful, Cubby.
Boken, signing out.